So this is Andrew Berkshire with Eyes on the Prize, here with Conor McKenna of TSN 690. And we're going to ask him about his life and how he became a sports radio personality and breaking into the industry here in Montreal, and as well as also the Habs, of course. So, Conor, was there a time that you realized that you wanted to be a sports radio guy, or was it just kind of something you fell into?
Maybe a little bit of both. And first of all, thank you very much for having me here.
Thank you for coming.
It's a very big honor. With the likes of Marc-Antoine Godin and Mike Boone, two of my favorite people to read about the Habs, it's kind of humbling and exciting to be asked to do something like this, so thank you.
Oh, no problem.
I was working in marketing for a long time. Am I supposed to look at the camera or you? I don't know.
It doesn't really matter.
What did the other guys
think? Everyone else looked at me. So.
They looked at you, okay. I was working in marketing for a company that did online gaming, goldenpalace.com. It's like a very, very big online casino. And we were doing really cool stuff, coming up with neat ways of marketing this thing that was basically illegal to market in traditional ways. So we couldn't do television commercials, we couldn't do magazine ads. So we had to come up with gimmicks and ways of promoting the brand through non-traditional ways. Anyway, it was a really cool job, it was fun. But unfortunately, a bunch of new laws came down and they had to basically shut down operations, which used to be on the South Shore and are now, I believe, offshore. So I got a severance out of it because, you know, it wasn't, I guess all of us were kind of taken care of. It was a company that was doing very well and they just kind of had to do what they had to do. So I bailed and I didn't have anything to do and I was sort of saying, you know what? What am I going to do? Am I going to look for another sort of a desky job or, you know, I want to do something fun. I've had a job that I enjoy. I've had jobs that I've hated, that I'm clock watching and hating. And people had always told me, you've got a great voice for radio. You should be doing radio. I mean, people, ever since I stopped having a really high voice, I guess when I was like 15 or 16, I was a little bit of a late bloomer. People have been saying that to me. And I love sports. So it was kind of a no-brainer for me. What I did was, my dad is in the media, so he knows a lot of people. So a friend of his named Stephen Fizicky is a terrific guy, a guy who's been here in Montreal doing great things in the media for a really long time. He gave me the number for Mitch Melnick. So I had Mitch's number, and then what I did was I believe it was basically a calendar year, I called Melnick three times a week. Until he actually, after a year, he finally took my call. You know, I'd leave him voicemails, hey, me again, just wanted to check in and let you know. And finally, he answered and he said, you know what, come by for a meeting. So I met him and we had a coffee and I sort of laid out what I wanted to do. And he told me they had a spot for me as an intern on the drive show. So that's how I got my foot in the door. And I got along well with Rod Francis and Andy Bennett, who were his people that he was working with at the time. And at the end of the summer, I was sort of at a point where I was like, I can't really keep working for free. I've got to do something. And they said, well, would you be interested in covering Canadians' home games? And of course, I answered, yes, I would definitely be interested in doing that.
No, that's not interesting.
So, I mean, that's it. I went from being a guy who probably, you know, I would pay my own money to go see 10, 15 Habs games a year to getting paid to go to hockey games, which is just preposterous.
Yeah.
I'm extremely fortunate.
So were you doing kind of like the same thing that Jess Rusnak does now?
Yeah. It was very, very similar to what Jess is doing. I mean, we've ramped it up since we got the rights on TSN 690. We now have more mics. We'll have someone in both rooms, which was not the case before. We were sort of operating on a shoestring budget, which we kind of still are, but the string is a little bit longer, I guess. But I was the one in the Habs room primarily, and then I would sort of dash over to the visitors' room, see if I could get something from the visiting coach, maybe a player or two, and then you dash back down the hall to do Carboneau or whoever the coach is at the time. So I was very much like what Jess does now, yeah.
So you got to go in on some of the entertaining Carbo press conferences?
They were definitely, it was a stark contrast to what Jacques Martin was like. You know, Martin had his occasional moments, but yeah, Carbo was cool. I mean, one of the first things I ever covered, actually, was, I can't remember exactly, it was out at Les Quatre Glaces in Pierrefonds. It was the rookie camp or something like that. And Mike Komisarek was injured at the time, and he was behind the bench sort of directing traffic, acting like an assistant coach, and I asked Carbo about it. I'm like, I don't know, what's up with the commissariat behind the bench like that? He's like, I'll let anyone coach. You want to coach? You want to get behind the bench and coach? And that was the first question I ever asked, and he offered me the opportunity to go coach, obviously, jokingly, but he was a lot of fun to deal with, for sure.
That was quite the eventful situation there with Carbo towards the end, especially. Were there, I guess obviously there were other careers you considered going into before you went into the radio thing, and it seems like you've got a knack for marketing, like you said you were in there. Was there something you were looking into, like sports marketing kind of thing, or was it just that's kind of where your life went after the casino stuff?
I don't know. I mean, no, I guess not really.
Not so much like PR kind of thing?
No, I'm not. I'm actually not really good at that. I'm like, no. I'm like really kind of often very abrasive and like sensitive and stuff. I'm like, I wouldn't be the person you'd want distilling your message. I mean, now that I've been doing what I've been doing for the last couple of years, and I think I have a much better grasp of it. I do a lot of writing, although not about sports, but I write tons of press releases in my other career. And it's something that I can now see myself doing. It's a cool job. I mean, Dominic Sion of the Canadiens, who's a fantastic guy, and really does a terrific job, and they've got a great staff over there. I think they're sort of the envy of the league, really, the way that they handle their PR and what they do. It's kind of a cool job, although at the same time, it's probably not that fun to be the party pooper sometimes and be like, oh no, or you're the one who's denying the story, right? I mean, if someone has a scoop, they'll probably go to him and try to get confirmation or get something. So he'll often be the guy who is sort of like, no comment or whatever, but it's an interesting field for sure.
It's kind of interesting that you know both sides, kind of like you can be the guy who's trying to get the story and you also know the side of the people who are trying to keep everything quiet.
Yeah.
It's kind of a unique perspective you have there.
It's true. And at the same time, like I would never pretend to be, one of these real story breakers, like I've certainly had a few moments or whatever.
But so you're not hockey insider?
I am not. I would never, I'm not a hockey insider. I am not. Although I do think I believe he's in the Montreal area, and yeah. I'm pretty sure he listens to the station. It's funny how that hockey insider thing broke, because once you heard who it supposedly was, and it was literally like a teenager, in his parents' basement, and then you read and you're really like, that's exactly who it is, there's no question. Even if they got it wrong and it's not that guy, it's like a guy two streets over in his parents' basement, for sure.
Working on the Habs post-game show that you guys got to start last year, which obviously we haven't been able to get to this year with the stupid lockout, but how do you personally handle all the crazy callers, and do you find it like almost more fun that the Habs kind of sucked last year because you get the craziness and it's almost hilarious? Like,
there's, I guess, two ways of looking at it, right? I mean, if you're hosting a call-in show, you need angry people, right? I mean, you can't just, that's the thing. Like, when the Canadiens were good a couple of years ago, when they were at the top of the East, for example, and when they're winning games consistently, it's like, what are you going to say? Oh, they're awesome. Carbo's doing a great job, I mean, Markov and Komisarek, what a pairing, then it's boring. I mean, it's no good. On the other hand, when they suck, definitely there's probably more you can come up with, but at the same, you ultimately will hit the same walls. I mean, you're like, yes, Thomas Cabrelet is terrible. Yes, Pierre Gauthier is like the worst general manager ever, but I mean, you're gonna ultimately hit the same thing because the Canadians were so consistently bad last year that it got to be tedious, man. It was the first time that I found myself being like, oh, there's a game tonight. And after doing this for 5 years, it was the first year where it was like, I work all day and then it's like, oh, go home right now and not go to the hockey game and watch the Canadians lose to the Carolina Hurricanes again, But then you kind of have to get a bit of a reality check and maybe my girlfriend or someone will be like, you take a step back and think about what you're saying right now and go to the hockey game.
Bored about covering the Canadians.
Yeah. I mean, it was a rough year, but not nearly. I mean, if I can compare and contrast with what I'm going through right now, it's not even close. I mean, it's, this has been totally devastating, what's happened here. For me, it's like my my fate is tied completely to the Canadians. If the Canadians are not playing, I get barely any work. So, you know, for me, this holiday season is less fun. I'm going to not be able to probably go on a vacation, and I'm still doing well, and I'm really happy, but this really, really sucks. It's like, it's... I try not to tweet about it, talk about it, or think about it, but it's really this.
It's a bad situation.
Now that I've been through this, they can be in the cellar for the next 5 years, and that's
and you're
that's
gonna be
fine.
Happy.
And as long as I have work and I'm able to talk hockey rather than talk lockout and wrap my head around and make whole provisions and whatever the hell else it is that they're doing, I'll be happy.
Well, you guys were dealt kind of like a double kick in the pants, where you had the threat of the station possibly not existing anymore as it exists now, which thankfully is now fixed. But then the lockout at the same time, it's like, how do you even handle all that?
Well, it's, I mean, you're right, and that's it, right? It's like a total emotional roller coaster. You're like, okay, well, we're not going to exist anymore, because that's really what it felt like, right? It was like, well, it's just a matter of time. It's a question of when we're done. There's no way the CRTC is going to stand up to this merger and whatever. So there's that, like, again, another like emotional high of like, wow, it's amazing, you know, we're safe, we can keep doing what we're doing. And then, of course, this lockout. So, I mean, look, I there's a lot of people besides me that are affected by this. John Bartlett, I mean, the voice of the Habs on our station, poor guy, gets his dream job of being the Habs play-by-play voice. I mean, literally, like, the job he has wanted his whole life. He gets it, and then the first year he's got to call a dead last place team. And then the next year, there is no next year. That's
yeah,
it.
Exactly. Yeah.
So it's, you know, I mean, there's a lot of us. And I mean, you know, and it's the same with you. You're doing a terrific job on the site. And then,
well, thank you.
But I mean, I'm sure in a perfect world, you wouldn't necessarily want to be doing Who Wore It Best features all the time.
No, nobody.
But, you know, I mean, it is what it is. There's only so much you can do. So
yeah, and it's the same kind of thing, is that we almost have to rely on somebody going nuts to get a lot of hits. Like we had on the site the other day, some guy came in and wrote like a huge comment in all caps.
Oh, yeah.
And we had an invasion of Leafs bloggers come in that just made fun of him. And you know, sometimes it's like Angry Sal that you guys used to
right,
get,
right?
It was
yeah.
one of those where it made no sense. And he was talking about how we should have hired Larry Robinson for the coach, but it was spelled Larry Ribbonsoing.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, I mean, that is true, though. That's what you need to get the conversation going, right?
Yeah.
And it's pretty much, comments are very much the same thing as callers. And if you're getting comments that are people like, dude, you're totally right. I mean, that's, you know, that's only going to go
thanks.
So far. Yeah.
That's the end of the conversation.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Do you find that there's going to be a difference this year with Therrien coming in? Do you have any hope that the Canadians are going to be a little bit better? Do you think it's kind of, you know, not much
this
change there.
This theoretical year, I mean,
yes.
Do you mean like this season, if this season were to happen?
Well,
or
sure,
next?
Let's say there's a 48 game season. Do you think the smaller schedule is an advantage or a disadvantage?
I think, I honestly think they could potentially be a playoff team, yeah. To be honest with you. I even last year, for me, they were the best last place team that I can remember in a long time. It was really ultimately a blessing what happened to them. Because if you're not going to make the playoffs, you might as well finish last.
Yeah.
And they were, I mean, they never got blown out of the water. You can go through that 82 game schedule. They beat good teams. They beat the Canucks, I believe. They beat the Red Wings. They consistently beat good teams, which was bizarre. They lost to bad teams, but it was always close games. It was 3-2, 4-3, 2-1. Overtime, shootout. How many shootout losses, right?
Yeah.
This was a team that left so many points on the board that I don't think they were that far away from competing. That's my personal opinion, which is why it's so encouraging to get a prospect like Galchenyuk out of something
yeah, exactly.
like that, and then to see what he's doing now. I mean, it couldn't be more promising, really. It's almost a dream scenario that he's bounced back the way that he has. So you've got this super prospect now tearing it up, and you don't have to worry about the team bungling his development, at least for now. So, I mean, really, if you're going to talk about teams that were sort of, in a way, positively affected by the lockout, I would say that the Canadians would probably be there. We'll see what happens draft-wise if it does come down to it, but it might be the Leafs who are best served by this lockout.
Yeah, they're one of the only teams that I think is eligible to have all of their draft balls in the lottery.
Right. I think they'd be the odds-on favorite. If it was the same format as last time, I think the Leafs would be the odds-on favorite. But I guess the interesting thing is that McKinnon, I guess he was never necessarily considered the Sidney Crosby of this draft in the sense that maybe it was going to be Jones. But now you've got this Drouin kid who's, I don't know, I mean, we'll see. But
he's got hands, hopefully, man.
At times, he's looked like the best player on his team, which is pretty cool. So that's been fun, and that was certainly the highlight of this morning's World Junior game, which was not exactly the best hockey game I've ever seen, but it was fun to watch that kid just undress the goalie, and to see the Canadian goaltender, who clearly sort of made a case to be the starter, I think.
Yeah, Binnington was a little bit more solid than Subban was on Thursday.
It's weird, right, because like, we're talking about this now, and then like, someone's watching this in 2 weeks, and they're just gonna be like, "Wow, like what an idiot!" Like Binnington, that guy
Subban
sucks.
Every game.
Subban was the MVP of the tournament. He was amazing. Anyway, sorry, I'm an idiot.
It's okay. I'll try to edit it to get it out quick, and we'll make sure that if we look stupid, it's at the right time.
And you know, I'll be, because I'm the one who's on camera, so I'm the one who's gonna bear the brunt of the anger. Maybe you'll get that all captured.
Just like don't check the comments.
Yeah, that's it. I always check the comments. It's it's my curse in life. On everything I read, I have to check the comments.
Do you have a favorite sports story that you've covered since you started covering the Canadiens?
Favorite sports story? Well, I mean, two things immediately come to mind. There's obviously the run to the conference finals a couple of years ago, being able to be in the building for some of those games. One in particular was Game 6 against the Penguins. That I took the night off, and a buddy of mine had tickets, like in the Reds, halfway up, right behind the penalty boxes. It was like the most ridiculous seats ever, like the best hockey game. That was really cool. That run was great. Obviously, it came to a ridiculous crashing halt against the Flyers, as it always seems to. And the other thing is, if I could think of an individual, a game or a moment, the 5-0 game, the Rangers with a 5-0 lead, and the Canadiens.
You got to be at that game?
Yeah, and that was, that was one of the only times in my life that I think it is the only time in my life that I left work at the hockey game. You know, I get all my clips, I have to go edit all my clips and then send them in. And I'm walking up De La Montagne, and it's like 11:30 at night, and I'm like buzzing, you know what I mean? Like, you're still buzzing. Like,
the energy, adrenaline going.
The Bell Center is, I've definitely been to a lot of rinks, a lot of arenas, and the Bell Center is a place that a lot of the time it's not so good, and it's kind of canned, and it feels weird, and you're like, are they pumping in noise? Because sometimes it feels like they are, but sometimes it's something else to be in that building. I mean, when that building comes alive, I don't think there's anything like it, and maybe I just say this because I'm from Montreal and I'm biased, but I don't think there's, not only in hockey, I don't think there's any building in sports that's like the Bell Center.
Well, then, during the 2010 run with Halak, I'm pretty sure they set a decibel record. The game where he had the 50-something saves against Washington.
Yeah, yeah.
It was absolutely insane. There's something special about hockey fans in Montreal, the way they react, and there's just an electricity in the air. Right?
Yeah, which is interesting too, because it's very important that we specify hockey fans.
Yeah.
And Expos fans, there was times when the Big O would get, and it was a building that it could sound a lot more full than it was. But I mean, you go to an Alouettes game, like, it's insane. Like, the people are there, and there are Alouettes fans that know football, but I mean, really, generally speaking, people are just sitting there schmoozing. They have no idea when to be loud. They have no idea when to be quiet. It's really weird. And they're good fans. They show up. They fill the building. But, I mean, I guess it's almost in our DNA in this city. And that's it, right? I mean, my dad brought me to the Forum when I was a kid. You know, I got to see games in the 93 run when I was a little kid. And I was 10 years old. But I remember standing room seats, like, that type of thing. And I think a lot of it is carried over to the Bell Center. I think there's a lot of people that would be like, it's not the same, and how could it be the same? They haven't won since, and there's definitely that hanging over it, but in its own right, it's a very special place.
Yeah, it was something that Boone mentioned as well, that it's something in the DNA of the people of the city.
Right? I swear I didn't. I haven't watched it yet.
No, you haven't watched it yet?
No, I haven't. No, I'm planning on watching it, but I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, it was great. Since you started covering the Canadiens, has there been a favorite incarnation, like, from year to year? It's mostly the same faces, but after the blow-up in 2009, kind of changed quite a bit.
Yeah.
Is there, like, a certain team that sticks out aside from the actual record of the team, that was like more fun?
I don't know. Last year's group was good. It's again, it's weird to say, but I guess last year's group with guys like Eric Cole, him in particular, but also Max Pacioretty, the way that he really emerged, those are both really thoughtful and intelligent guys who really, really care. And I think that was something I liked, and Carey Price too. I think, look, he did not have a great season. I mean, nor did the team, and I certainly wouldn't hold him accountable. But Carey's a really, I think he's an intelligent guy and a very funny and cool guy who's not necessarily easy to get to know. But the care level for those guys, those three guys in particular, especially Cole, who I think is sort of the guy who raised the bar as far as that goes. You could tell, man, like that guy is intense. And he cares, and it really pissed him off what happened last year. He had options. He chose to come to Montreal. He's had a lot of, we obviously know he's had a lot of success in the Bell Centre and has killed the Canadiens in the past.
Yeah.
And there was other places he could have gone. And he chose Montreal, I'm sure, because he thought this was a team, maybe not necessarily a cup team right now, but a team that was going to compete and to continually lose games. Because they weren't just losing games, they were like, Every loss was like a gut punch loss, it felt like, you know. Again, it was they were in these games, right? They were not blown out of the water in my mind really all season long. And he was always so pissed, you know, and he's also a guy who, I love this. When someone asks a really stupid question, he'll just like stare at the person and give them like a ridiculous, obvious answer, you know, and just be like, or he'll make fun of them, which is terrific, because you know what? It's not just in the sports media, it's in the media in general that these awful, awful questions are tossed around, you know? How did you feel about that second goal? Or like really general, uninteresting questions that show that you probably have not been paying any attention and you have no idea what's going on. Whether it's in the White House or at the Bell Centre, people are asking questions like that all the time. And he's a guy who will call you out on it. Pacioretty is another, he's a really smart guy who, you know, he gives you what I feel like is a pretty straight-up and honest answer when you ask him a question. So I think there was a good level of accountability. I mean, if you look at the two sides of the spectrum, Cole being the veteran, sort of, I guess, the guy who led the way as far as that goes, and Pacioretty being an up-and-coming guy who was clearly looking to his line mate, I think, as inspiration. I know it sounds ridiculous, and it was the least fun actual season for me from a personal standpoint, but I think that was a pretty good group they had there. I mean, especially considering, can you imagine what it feels like to be, because, you know, they never talk about it, and you can never get them to talk about it, but to be Eric Kohler, to be one of the guys who's in that room when Pierre Gauthier is the guy in charge, and, I mean, like, really, like, what are you thinking when, you know, when this is happening, like, okay, so Michael Camilleri criticized the team. Okay, now he's been pulled off the bench, and he just got traded to Calgary for Rene Bourque and Patrick Holland. Like, did that actually just happen? Michael Camilleri, in the middle of a game against the Bruins, a game that they were in, I believe, right?
Yeah, they were down by one goal.
Right. So they were in that game. They ship out arguably, well, I guess not really arguably with Cole and Pacioretty there, but one of their best snipers on a team that doesn't have a lot of them. And that's just one thing. Man, it was the day of our Christmas party last year, TSN, it was almost a year ago today, that the Cabrillet trade happened. And my reaction to, I mean, like, can you imagine that to be, it's one thing for us, who are like, they're observing the team, we're like, holy crap, this is crazy. But those guys are on the ice. I mean, they know what's going on.
Or a coach fired, like, 20 minutes before.
Right, I mean, right, so time after time after time. But, I mean, the thing is, it's that's why it's really cool to have candid conversations with players, and unfortunately that type of thing is rarely sort of relayed to people, and now I sound like I'm bragging or something, but like, what I'm trying to say is that these guys do think about that stuff, and we maybe as fans and observers aren't necessarily as aware as we should be of really what's going through these guys' heads, because they have opinions about Pierre Gauthier and what he's doing to this hockey team. Like, there's no question about it, and we never really get to find out what those things are, but they, I mean, if you think the fans were angry, what, can you imagine being in that room, and you're like, what? We just traded Spacho? like the nicest guy ever, who everyone loved. We just traded him for Thomas Caverley, who signed for 3 more years after this one. Like, is that actually a thing that just happened? Like, oh my god. I think that was the worst one. That's the one I harped on the most, was the Caverley one. It was just like, Jim Rutherford had come out and been like, oh, I made a huge mistake.
Right after the trade, he was like, well, Caverley's a terrible player, so we got Spodjic now. I was like, that's so unprofessional.
And I know, it's almost like he just doesn't really think much of Gauthier or whatever.
It seemed that way, that there was just so little respect throughout, well, definitely in the media. Gauthier made that bet himself here with the media, but also the way Rutherford acted after the trade was like, yeah, I pulled one on him.
Yeah.
I got him. And it's like, did the GM really just say that in the NHL?
It's true. But you know, maybe it was just because it was so obvious. You know what I mean? Like, my 8-year-old little sister was like, what? Like, it's, you know what I mean? Like, this was beyond. It was just in a career of completely mind-blowing moves that this guy made time after time after time, and somehow getting lucky at times. Look, I mean, he is the one who signed Eric Cole. I mean,
that's the confusing thing, is that he'd make a great move and then he'd trade Camilleri.
Yeah, but you know, though, right? Because I mean, if you're really going to look at the timeline, you know, he felt like he was dug at personally by Camilleri, and he is a spiteful person, and this was, you know, he acted in anger, something you never want to do, right? You never. It's like, if you, I don't know if you've been in this situation, but you get an email from someone where you're just like, what? Like, are you kidding me with this email? And then, and like, I've done it, like, where I'm like, I write a whole thing, and then I'm like, you know what? I think I'm gonna let this sit in my drafts overnight. I'm gonna revisit this tomorrow. That's precisely what he should have done in that situation. Be like, you know what? I'm angry right now. I probably shouldn't make any big decisions about player personnel while I'm feeling like this. I'd go down to Vermont, eat a couple of salads, come back, and see where this goes. Which obviously is not what he did. And now, I mean, what, Patrick Holland? I mean, he's not going to play, is he? I don't think so.
I'm not
maybe,
sure.
Maybe a fringe player at best. And Rene Bork, well, who knows? Maybe he'll find motivation and decide that he cares again and whatever. But it certainly didn't seem like it. Although he did have his moments. They were using him on the PK, which was really weird.
He was actually pretty good on the PK. But I guess he was also paired with either Eller or Plekanec at all times. And both of them are ridiculously good on the PK. So
true.
Kind of covers him up. He's also got the abdominal surgery in the summer, so pretty tough road for him to come back.
Yeah, well, he doesn't have to worry about that now. I guess we're pretty much at the time that he was supposed to come back.
Yeah, although I think it was Justin Bourne talking about it, that kind of injury, it's pretty much the year is...
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, even if you're playing, you just don't have the core strength to be an effective player.
Oh.
You have to build it back up, so... Probably not much to look forward to from Rene Bork this year.
Remember, he played, you know, that's, you know, one thing that went through my mind when he made that fade was, maybe the only time Pierre Gauthier's ever seen Rene Bork play was at the Heritage Classic, because he was so good for the Flames in that game, right? He, like, dismantled the Canadians. He was like a wrecking crew, and Gauthier's like, oh, what a player this guy, Bork must be. And then, of course, he gets on the phone and decides he wants to add him to the team. I mean, you know, maybe something good can come of it. Maybe there's still time for him to turn it around. If we ever have hockey again, maybe he'll be an effective player.
Well, he's signed for like 4 more years, so...
Yes. Yes, he is.
He does have time on
his
side.
He does,
yes. Sure.
Yes, and so do Habs fans. Yeah. Is it? It's not 4 more years, is it?
It's 3 or 4. Yeah. It might be 3. It was a long contract when he signed it. It's about for the same money as Kostitsyn had, mm-hmm. but...
Yeah, 3.5.
The term is the big deal for Rene Bork.
Well, that's the thing, man, about these contracts, is that if you do have a Rene Bork or you know, whoever, if you're going to give a guy guaranteed money for such and such years, there's a good chance that, maybe not a good chance, but there's a chance that he's just going to not really care that much, because no matter what he does, he's getting paid, right?
Yeah. And especially when you've got a guy who has that history, right, of not always giving everything that he has to.
That's why it's important to do your homework, as Jacques Martin would say, which clearly Pierre Gauthier did not do.
It's pretty bad when you get pulled over on a trade by what's his face in Calgary there? The GM.
Yeah.
The guy who used to be Jay Feaster.
Jay Feaster.
Jay Feaster.
I know.
Because he's been pretty bad for quite a long time.
And he's a Stanley Cup winning general manager, though, isn't he? Right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing to think that in the last 10 years, he's a Stanley Cup winning GM, which is totally bizarre. But he's been like the Flames. Really, if you're a Flames fan, I think you could be, if you're a Habs fan, you could look at a team like the Flames and be like,
we're not so bad.
Yeah, things could be a lot worse than they are right now.
We could have one good prospect in the entire system.
And even then, not necessarily a sure thing.
Yeah.
Right? Whereas, I mean, that's the Habs instantly in Galchenyuk got as close to a sure thing as you're really going to get, at least by the looks of it, health permitting.
And even aside from Galchenyuk, like, that draft was excellent. You've got guys like Kolberg, who's looking great for Sweden, got another point today.
Yeah.
And Hudon.
It's too bad, right? I mean, that's one of the more fun things, I think, about the World Juniors is when you've got a Habs prospect to watch, and Brendan Gallagher being a terrific example of that last year, and obviously P.K. Subban in the past. It definitely adds a layer of excitement, but it's cool at least that a guy like Kolberg on Sweden is going to be an impact player on that team. That is good. And Quebecers, which is very cool.
Yeah, always nice to have a homeboy coming in, right? Especially one that's good enough to make the team, possibly in the next couple of years.
Yeah, no, it is. It makes it more fun to watch, and maybe more worth waking up at ungodly hours to do so.
On TSN 690, are you guys just to expand your coverage during the lockout and what you can talk about? Do you guys do much Bulldogs stuff, or you mostly keep that? I know you're covering some of the games. You run Derek Will's play-by-play, I believe.
Right.
Do you talk much on the radio? Does anybody call in?
Look, I mean, I don't really host a lot of programming, to be honest with you, during times like this. I'm going to be doing Mitch's show over the holidays. So if you're watching this...
Listen.
I will be on the air from 3 to 7 I believe the 27th, the 28th, and then the 2nd, 3rd, and 4th of January. And for sure, I mean, that's something that I'm going to want to get to. But generally speaking, I can't honestly say that I've, from what I hear, that I hear a whole ton about the Bulldogs, which is too bad. I mean, there are definitely resources that we can tap into and get stuff on. It's unfortunately, and everyone talks about how bad they are, and they're definitely not good. I mean, there's no question. The games that I've had a chance to watch, though, I think there's reason for optimism. Sylvain Lefebvre is a rookie coach, too. I mean, that's not going to help, but it's a very young team. And they're sort of learning and growing together, which is, I think, is a good thing. Although, who knows how it's going to play out in the end. But what I'm trying to say is it doesn't help that they kind of suck. I guess if I'm going to try to put a point on it.
It's a growth year, basically. Too many rookies, and they were dealt a big blow with Jeffrion going out with a horrific injury, and then Pelushai's out now too, so their two veteran scoring forwards are gone, and Louis LeBlanc has got a high ankle sprain, but he's still playing, but he can't really skate right now.
Right, and that's one of those pesky injuries that'll sort of stick with you
all year. Yeah. I mean, if it can slow down Sidney Crosby, it's going to slow down Louis LeBlanc.
You're right about that. He doesn't have, you know what, he just doesn't have the same lower body strength that Sidney Crosby has.
No. Not many players do.
I don't think anybody on earth does.
No. It may be like Jaromir Jagr in his prime used to be like that, or maybe Peter Forsberg.
I remember, actually, this is actually the first thing that I covered by myself. And I went to, it was a Penguins morning skate, and they're doing their media availability in the locker room, and after a morning skate, it tends to be sort of catch as catch can. It's not like after a game when everyone's just there. So Crosby comes out, and everyone's, you know, all the cameras are there. The score is a camera. Sportsnet's got a camera. There's four French cameras. There's tons of cameras, and the cameramen are always pushing you around and being jerks. Look, cameramen. I'm there, and I'm looking around, and then Sidney Crosby comes out. So everyone's got to get out of the way, and he comes through, and he's taking off his equipment, and I guess he had to go grab something out of the upper part of his locker, and so he gets up on his locker and he turns around and he's doing, and I'm like, I look and I see this guy's lower body, I'm like, holy crap, like it's crazy, actually crazy, you know, and so what happened was, this is something I learned early about Melnick in the afternoon, is that I get into the car with Andy Bennett the next day, and she's like, so, you know, how did it go? And I'm like, oh, yeah, it was crazy. It was, you know, it was super cool, you know, like Sidney Crosby, Evgeny Malkin, I mean, all these guys. And, man, like, have you seen Sidney Crosby? Like, have you seen his lower body? It's insane. And she's like, yeah, I know, blah, blah, blah. So I think that's the end of it. So, of course, no, Andy goes and tells Mitch that I was very impressed with Sidney Crosby's lower body. And so this turns into a whole thing about basically them making fun of me because I was, you know, so taken with Sidney Crosby's butt. So they gave me a hard time about that. That's one thing about Melnick in general, and you know, I can't. There's nobody who I would rather learn from in radio, and I, you know, he's sort of like, I feel like he's been a mentor to me, and he's really been good to me. You guys have been really good to me over the years. Is that no topic is off limits when it comes to Mitch. I mean, if you tell him something, as long as you're not like, you know, my wife had a miscarriage, or that's like an awful, terrible example. I don't know why I thought of that. I'm not married, and that never happened to me. But like, you know, basically no topic is off limits, with the very rare exception of something devastating and personal.
He makes it fun.
Yeah. I mean, even now, right? It's, you know, to do 4 hours a day with no hockey in Montreal, it's like...
That's tough.
Yeah. But he does it, man. He talks. He talks with Pierre Maguire every day for 20 minutes,
with no hockey.
And there's no hockey going on like that. And Pierre's not even doing the World Juniors anymore. You know what I mean? Like it's pretty crazy, and it's good. It's good radio. You know, it's really it's something to aspire to, and something that I could probably work my whole life and never get anywhere close to where he is. So it's something to strive for, I guess.
We'll disagree with you there, and we'll say, we'll get you. Well, you'll get there.
Thank
you'll
you. There, thank you. Sure. You're very kind.
Thanks for doing this, Connor, and I wish you all the luck in the world with TSN 690 in the future, and I'd like to hear you on the radio as much as possible. So hopefully we get a hockey season on, and you can get your post-game show back.
I hope so. I hope that happens, and I get my XM show back, and I can start making money again. But you know what? Thank you for the kind words. Thank you so much for inviting me to be here. Thank you, viewer, for watching this video. If you made it all the way through my insane ramblings and 3-minute answers, reminding myself of Noel Butler here. But thank you, and Andrew, thank you very much for having me, man.
Oh, thanks again, and no problem. And I guess we'll title this Sidney Crosby's Butt.
Please do so, or just like maybe you could even like cut up my story in such a way that it sounds even more insane than it was.
It'll be like Conor McKenna quote. I love Sidney Crosby's Butt.
There you go. That's me. Yeah, that'll be the title of the video.
Thanks again, Connor.
Cheers.